everything.
I want to stay on critical race theory. And you said something that I thought was really important, which is that the claim of systemic racism generalizes the party responsible for the injury, such that you no longer have a specific individual who's been accused of an act. You have a society that's been accused of some ether, some atmospheric wrong. And that means that there's no way really to effectively respond to the charge. And it means that people are going to be making claims at law based upon non-rebuttable assertions of injury or something like that. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? Because that seemed, I haven't heard that before.
What happens is, I've seen this in particular context. For example, is there discrimination based on race in the provision of organ donors through the organizations that provided in the United States? Well, the answer is probably no, because they're technical grounds, but you could raise that. And I've been to many a medical injury meeting in which this claim is started to give. And you look around, every doctor in the room is essentially a liberal Democrat. None of them are guilty, but they're all prepared to say that the system is willing to do this. And the reason that you never attack individuals is they will defend themselves. And if you hear enough individual defenses coming up, you'll realize that, this charge is completely bogus. And so what happens is if you make it ethereal, then all the people who essentially are liberal can join in the attack because they're not attacking themselves individually. And so it's a very, very clever strategy. Now, what happens is some people are willing to step up. There's that battle that is taking place between the teachers unions on the one hand and that black woman, I think, who's trying to say, bring them on, I'll fight them. And Joseph Epstein, just this morning, he's no relation of mine, wrote this piece about the culture war saying this is so terrible, we have no choice but to continue to fight on the pages of the Wall Street Journal. So what's happened is, I think, in fact, the effort to take over the curriculum has brought forth a charge of overreach. And you now see the 1776 movement coming abroad.
Of which I would say,
we understand there's a lot of things that are wrong with the history of the United States, but there are also a lot of things that were nice. You mentioned before the show that I wrote a book called Forbidden Grounds on the anti-discrimination laws back in the early 1990s,
right,
in which I traced at some painful length some of the history of segregation that existed. But you start with that, and then, starting around 1915, the iceberg starts to melt, and it's a bunch of white conservative guys who are basically breaking it down. So the grandfather clauses, which said you can only vote if your grandfather can vote, all of a sudden those are declared unconstitutional. And then the checkerboard map in a case called Buchanan and Wally, which says blacks can live on the black squares and whites can live on the white scale, that struck down at that particular year. Then, 1930, you get the Scottsboro Boys, right? A place called Powell versus Alabama. And all of a sudden, these convictions are reversed. The poor kids' lives are ruined, but it starts to change them. The ACLU comes along, and it turns out you now have very effective litigation, and it forms an alliance with the NAACP, which was formed in 1910. To give you an idea of what the climate was, Wilson had segregated the civil service in 1913 or 14. Because he was a kind of a Southerner from Virginia and New Jersey.
Yeah.
And the NAACP, 2 years before, said, we can't challenge this in court. Because there would have been no way they could have won after Plessy v. Ferguson. And they knew this, right? But by the time you start getting to the 1930s, all of this is beginning to unravel, thank God. And the first of the blows, in many ways, is to give you a 1946 case. I'm sure you've never heard of the Dormant Commerce Clause as a working doctrine.
Dormant Commerce Clause. No, I have not heard of it. But I want everybody to know that this litany on which you were embarked is in the service of establishing that, notwithstanding a history of slavery, racism, and Jim Crow, the legal institutions and the political orientation of the United States of America has been able effectively, in the fullness of time, to address and redress those injuries.
Yes,
and hence, 4th of July is something that we should be celebrating, all things considered, not being unaware of the historical problems that you have identified.
Yeah. So essentially what happens is you used to run trains on interstate railroads. And in the northern states, you'd integrate. And then you go down to Virginia, you'd have to separate. And this slows down commerce. The Dormant Commerce Clause says that if there's an impediment to the free flow of people on trains and buses and so forth, you have to have a strong justification to let it go. And the Southerners put forward segregation, and the Supreme Court struck it down. So the first blow on the transportation stuff comes out of the Commerce Clause, not out of the Equal Protection Clause. You know, 4 years later, there's a case called Sweat v. Painter, in which they were separate but equal. What does that mean? There was a black school which was put in some unheated room with 16 books as a substitute for the white school at the University of Texas Law School. And the Supreme Court, in what was actually a dicey case, struck that down as well. And all the major deans of the law schools, Irving Griswold, Edward Levy, and so forth, they basically signed the brief saying that this is not allowed to stand. So for the first time, you start seeing the establishment inside the institutions weighing in. And, you know, I keep reminding people, it's not all that easy to weigh in when the dominant culture runs the other way. These were not sunshine sailors. These were guys who took some personal risk, and they were prevailed. Brown comes along. Of course, it's a very controversial decision. They backslide a little bit in Brown, too, and so forth. But then what you do is you have Cooper and Aaron. There's another case in which it turns out that with a little bit of dicey and maneuvering, what it is said is that the Supreme Court can tell the world what is, in fact, constitutional. The branches are not equal and coordinate. And they got to do something about this. And so when Eisenhower did it, essentially, they gave him cover. And you then start to see the movement and all the rest of this stuff. When I was raised in the early 60s, the way we did this history was so much different. We said we started in a bad place and we managed to work ourselves to a good faith. And we tended to do at that time at Columbia College, for example, was to praise the improvements rather than to damn the institutions for taking so long to improve.
And that would be your preference for pedagogy today? I still think,
I mean, look, I don't know. Do you remember Marian Anderson and
the, oh, yes, the opera singer that
yes, the great singer. And they, the Daughters of the Revolution refused to let her do it in their home. Yeah. Remember what Eleanor Roosevelt did?
She invited her somewhere to sing.
It was at the White House. Of the Washington Monument.
Oh, the monument. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, and then I don't know if you remember about the Tuskegee Airmen.
Yeah, I remember that. But listen, I got to stop you because we're running out of time. And that's good. And what you're doing now is, I think, giving voice to one idea, an idea which I would affirm about how we should be teaching our kids.
Yes.
What the critical race theory advocates want to do is teach them in a very different way. And you liken this to the creation science versus Darwinian evolution debate and how you manage it. And a question I have is, how can we manage this? I mean, one thing you can do is get local school boards, you know, meetings and parents coming in and demanding. What role is the law playing here? Because states are passing statutes that are trying to forbid the teaching of critical race theory, and defendants of critical race theory are saying that's violating the free speech rights of the...
When you're doing in terms of running a school. I mean, school boards have...
So you're okay with statutes banning... Would you ban the teaching of Marxism, et cetera?
No, I mean, as I say, it's all... I would not even ban the teaching of critical race theory, but I would demand would ban a situation in which the only thing you're allowed to teach is critical race theory and treat everything else as disinformation. They have to agree that they're at risk along with everybody else. And in fact, Glenn, the single most dangerous word in the entire lexicon these days is the assertion of too many people who ought to know better that the people whom they disagree with are spreading disinformation. And so therefore, we should be able to ban them. And this is true.
Some of those people are running huge platforms in Silicon Valley.
Yes. But I mean, you know, take eminent scientists, we ban them. We take conservative publications, we don't put them on Wikipedia and things like that. Now, it turns out that, you know, many of these are people with whom I agree on some issues. I am always at risk to being proved wrong in a debate. What I am not prepared to do is to have somebody who purports to be neutral and say that I can determine who's allowed to participate in the debate. And since your views are misinformation, I can silence you on my platform and try to get other people to do that. I regard that as just defamation of people with whom you start to disagree.